I'm Alexandra, a psychic spiritual counselor, and welcome to Alexandra's Psychic Eye. Though we wake each day in the same physical form, our bodies carry a cellular memory of former lifetimes and the people we used to be. As we go through our day, memories are triggered from these forgotten times, allowing past personalities to participate in the present. A situation may arise that will remind us of a similar event from long ago, allowing us to confront and cleanse away the negative emotions that grow out of it. The universe helps us here by repeating the same circumstances so that we can at last disengage ourselves to begin a life of pure freedom from the past. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Alexandra's Psychic Eye. Are you scared by the paranormal activities going on in your home? Well, don't be. Tonight, we have with us two of the creators and lead investigators from the very popular series, Scared, Brian Cano and Chris Mancuso. Since 2002, they have taken us on an exciting tour as they explored various abandoned and haunted locations across the country. A few of the locations they have investigated include the Lizzie Borden House, Snug Harbor, Ramblewood House, and the Shanley Hotel. Chris is also a successful screenwriter, and Brian can be seen weekly on The Haunted Collector, now in its second season on the Sci-Fi Channel. And welcome, guys. And
Hi.
You've been here before.
Yes, I have.
And welcome to
First
the
time.
Show.
Thanks
We're really happy
us.
To hear. Great. Thanks for coming. Now, you began exploring abandoned buildings, which eventually led to investigating locations. Does anything scare you at this point?
Sure. I mean, I'm just a guy. I'm very vulnerable to things. So, I mean, still falling through a floor somewhere would, you know, that's a scary thing. Or running into people in an abandoned place. That's a scary thing. And the paranormal can also still be scary.
Well, talk to the viewers about the paranormal experiences that scare you. Because here you've been in a lot of places, a lot of situations, which we're going to go into. Okay. What has scared you, Chris?
It's been disturbing actually learning that the paranormal does exist. Because for the longest time, I was a skeptic. And then learning that, wow, this stuff is real. There are all these kind of spirits and entities out there. And it's like, well, what else is out there? And it just kind of really just blew my mind, you know?
Yes. Has anything scared you, Brian? Really frightened you?
I would say plenty of things scare me, but I think fear is a natural part of the human condition.
Right.
It's what kept our, you know, far ancestors alive back when we were just a, you know, drooling race in caves. And I think it keeps us sharp. It's what you do with that fear. I get scared all the time. I don't always react.
So you're walking into a building, and something hits you that really frightens you. What was that? What was like, oh my God, like that, like, oh, wow, this is scary, I want to get out of here.
I think it depends. On Scared, the documentary series is twofold. There's urban exploration and paranormal investigation. So the urban exploration side is very much the physical dangers of a rotting, crumbling building. We could fall through floors, the ceiling could collapse on us. There's lots of physical dangers for us to tangle with, and that is scary. We're concerned for our physical well-being.
Yes. Well, this is sort of a two-part question then. As paranormal investigators, you take physical, emotional, spiritual, and psychological risks when you guys are investigating a haunted location. How do you protect yourself from the onslaught of buried memories, trauma that may be hidden in these places, while you're dredging up the past, floors that could, you know, break and you can go down. And was there ever an investigation that really made you concerned for your safety?
Well, I'm gonna answer.
Like, we really want to get, you know,
one part
into that.
You were talking about how you protect yourself, I guess, kind of emotionally, or, you know,
yeah.
I never used to, but right now I wear a crucifix. And I'm not the most religious person in the world,
right?
But if you believe in, you know, spirits and paranormal and heaven and hell, you know, I always tell people, you got to pick a side and protect yourself. So, sure, go into a haunted location. It's nothing wrong with saying a little prayer, you know what I mean, something like that.
So you say a little prayer before you go in.
I say, sure.
Okay, so you're scared, but you go right in. So that's bravery, because bravery is going in, no matter how frightened you are. You feel the same way, Brian?
Absolutely. Like I said, you know, it's what you do with that fear. You could either turn and run or face it and move forward.
So you guys want to run, but you go in. It's like firemen. They, you know, everybody else is running out of the building, and they're running in. Okay. Now, so you protect yourself by praying, wearing your crucifix. How do you protect yourself?
I'm a less religious person. I guess I would say I'm more spiritual at this point. Mm-hmm. I have a St. Benedict's medal sewn into my uniform. So, I have things that I feel, maybe it's superstition, maybe it's wanting to protect myself. But when we go into a place, I don't say prayers, but I feel confident in knowing that when I go in, I'm here for a specific purpose. Anything negative, anything evil, you cannot touch me. And
wonderful.
It could be stupidity, the mask is bravery, but...
No. It's actually, I'm a spiritualist, okay? And I know, you know, and I've been to a lot of places that are very haunted. I did a show for Channel 5 years ago, Simsbury, Connecticut, the Chart House, Gordon Elliott show. The restaurant, which was a house that had burnt down and was rebuilt, it was haunted. People who worked in the restaurant were being thrown down stairs, injured, ending up in the hospital with broken legs. Dishes were being thrown around the room in locked rooms. It was a nightmare. So they called me to go in there and go through the house, inch by inch, room by room, floor by floor. And it was a huge place, and it was very haunted. And what I saw was the spirit of the young woman that lived there. She was Dutch. Her husband at the time, I believe this was the 1700s, he found out that she was cheating on him with his nephew, who lived in the house. He was an indentured servant. And as a result of finding out that she was pregnant with his baby, he chopped off her head in the kitchen.
I mean, that'll do it.
Yeah, and those days, you were allowed to do that. You better believe it.
Right.
And being that he was a wealthy man and he owned the land, anyway, nobody really knew how the wife was killed. I knew how the wife was killed.
Okay.
Anyway, everything that I said was confirmed in that she was killed in the house. They didn't know how. And in the room that I went to, the kitchen, it was, even though the house was burnt down, they kept the kitchen in the same area. And when the cameras were on the kitchen, I saw the whole bloody scene. And it was so horrific that I wanted to vomit. Mm. And I had to get out of there, but I was still describing it. So have you had experiences like that where you just... I knew it couldn't touch me, but it was so horrifying to see this. Have you had experiences like that where you could feel things and it was horrible?
I'm not psychically sensitive at all.
That's
I'm
good.
Like dead as a doornail.
That's why, Chris, you can do these things because you don't feel it. It was horrific for me because I do feel every single emotion. So that's good.
Right, but you also chose to respond to the call. You chose to go to respond to the call for help. You put yourself in that position to say, yes. All right, you needed help, I'm going to be here. And because of your gift receiving this information, you know, I think that's positive, and that's, you know, what we all do, whether you have abilities or less so. And
well,
that's
and
what
you know
we
what?
Try to do.
Just to clarify, and I'm sure you've heard this before, everyone on the planet Earth has these abilities. We're all psychic.
Right.
Not everyone chooses to use them, and not everyone's gifts are out there or are ready to use them. So, see, now I understand why you're able to just go into these places, because you don't...
Well, I didn't even believe in it for the longest time, so...
I know.
I mean, I'm going on an investigation, I'm going to... There's nothing there. What is there to be afraid of other than,
yes.
you know, the
have
physical
you ever
danger?
Brought, have you ever brought someone who wasn't intuitive like me, who is highly sensitive with you?
Well, the way our team is structured is we call it the three-pillar system. Mm-hmm. Psychic, skeptic, scientist. So they're pretty much checks and balances for everything. And like
very
a baseball
good.
Team, you can't have a team filled with pitchers. Mm-hmm. You need a catcher, first baseman, outfielders, and that's
absolutely.
How our team works. So
wonderful.
We always work with a psychic or multiple psychics.
Very good. That's great.
It's just another avenue.
What about you? Are you sensitive? Do you feel things like I did? And you know, what do you feel?
Lately, I get hunches. I'm like Chris. I don't consider myself to be someone who is open that way.
Uh-huh.
And pretty much every psychic I know says, "You're stop. You've got the gift." And I'm
well,
like,
you're
"Look,
very, your gift is right out there." I mean, it's...
See, I just feel that I'm observant. You know, I can evaluate a situation.
That's
I don't
good.
Call it psychic, but it's, you know, you live on the planet long enough, you kind of learn a couple of things, and you learn from experience. So that's what I attribute
Brian,
my
what's a hunch
observation
that
to.
You've had that's, you know, that it wasn't obvious, but you walked in and, you know, your hunch came right out?
That's a tough one. I feel like the more cases we do, the more investigations we go on, it's no longer a, let's find out what's going on. You walk mm-hmm. in and you're almost like, yeah, I know what's going on in here. I bet it's going to be this. I bet this is what's happening here.
So maybe your gifts are being brought out as you go in. Okay. Now, we have a clip from Scared right now. So would you set it up for us before we see it?
Okay. We've been doing the series Scared for the past 10 years. And the last project we did started out as an episode of Scared, but it became so big, there was so much history, so much richness to this location. It's actually on Staten Island. It's called Snug Harbor.
Okay.
And the documentary is called
Camera,
Haunted Snug Harbor.
Maybe we can move it a little closer if you want me to. Okay. Here we go. Do. There, I don't know if the camera can see it, but it's the best we're going to do.
Yeah, that looks good.
Okay, it's Haunted Snug Harbor. Okay. So we're going to set it up, and
this is a trailer from this documentary.
A trailer from Haunted Snug Harbor. Okay.
Literally willed into existence, Sailor Snug Harbor was created in 1801 by a man named Robert Richard Randall.
By the beginning of the 20th century, there were over 1,000 seamen there.
This was a very elite lifestyle, a well-endowed institution, one of the richest and the most prestigious benevolent institutions in all of America.
Things began to change, however.
Murder at Snug Harbor.
Snug Harbor is almost as rich in rumors of hauntings as it is in maritime history.
We had heard stories of water turning on and off, footsteps on the stairs.
Anybody up there?
I felt a sudden coolness on my cheek. It was very creepy.
I've had screws thrown at me.
Now, the only way to know for certain what's really going on here is to conduct a full investigation.
Captain Randall, are you here?
Sometimes in these places we'll hear noises. Often they can be explained. Sometimes there is no explanation.
I never really believed in ghosts until I got to Snug Harbor. I am a believer now.
I am Captain Robert Richard Randall, and this is my legacy.
That's really fantastic. Really interesting.
Yeah, that makes me actually want to see it. Oh, my God.
I'd go see that.
I'll go see that. Now, tell us a little bit about your experience at Snug Harbor.
Well, I mean, our experience was twofold, partially as documentarians and partially as investigators. And I have to say, as we're both, you know, you have to do the research and learn all about the history to get to those nuggets of truth buried within all the rumors mm-hmm. about the alleged activity at Snug Harbor. And we spent the better part of a year making that documentary.
What were the rumors about Snug Harbor? Bring us up to date on that for the viewers that don't know.
In like the matron's house, mm-hmm. you know, there's a lot of different buildings on the grounds.
Matron as in the care.
Right, which, you know, cared for the. Yeah, she was like the leader of all the women who kind of worked on the premise. Mm-hmm. And supposedly, you know, there's a woman still seen floating around in that.
The year would be?
1800s.
1800s.
Mid to late 1800s, I would say. And people have still seen this kind of woman in white figure in the matron's house and several other locations. Mm-hmm. That's one of the many hundreds of rumors about the place.
What did she look like? What have people reported she looks like?
Various rumors that we've heard. I've never seen her. Uh-huh. Wish I could say that I have, but I haven't. But, uh-huh. you know, a lot of people say it's a flowing white dress, or they see outside a woman in a flowing white dress. And, you know, I'm not sure if they confuse two different apparitions, because you get reports of the same kind of type of apparition in different places.
Right. Okay. And
one of the other apparitions that is commonly seen on the grounds of Snug Harbor is Captain Randall. Captain Robert Richard Randall, who in his will bequeathed his land to have this place set up to allow aged and decrepit sailors to come retire here. They say that his spirit is seen walking the grounds or looking off to Manhattan, because he was originally buried in Manhattan and his body was exhumed and brought to Snug Harbor. So,
where did he live, his house?
That was in Manhattan.
His house was in Manhattan. He was very much a metropolitan person. He was friends with Alexander Hamilton. His father was also a seaman by trade. I believe he was a privateer, which
His father was like a privateer, which is, you know, everybody knows, kind of a legalized pirate.
Legalized piracy.
So you had, I believe, you had a psychic there. I think the woman with the dark hair.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what did she feel about the? The house.
Well, Lisa Ann is our group psychic, and she's very good. And actually, me starting out as a skeptic and Chris mm-hmm. being skeptical, I think mm-hmm. she's shown both of us a lot of things that really open our minds to things.
Yeah, and like I said, like she did an investigation of all these different kind of buildings. So just to kind of sum it up in one sentence, it's kind of hard, but I mean, she definitely picked up activity there.
What kind of activity did she pick up?
Well, in different locations, there's kind of, mm-hmm. she's, you know, different emotions. Although I can't, like, really pick up on that stuff, so I have to kind of trust her. But she said, you know, on a whole, she said it felt very kind of relaxed, like this was a happy place. And she didn't know anything about this location before we took her there.
Well, that's good. That's how you want. That's when I did the show for Gordon Elliott on the haunted Simsbury chart house, I told them, don't tell me anything. And I said, this place had burnt down. And after the fact, I said, yes, it did. It was rebuilt. You know, because you don't want to know anything, because then you don't know if you're seeing it, because
they want to be tainted.
You want fresh.
That's part of our process. I mean, myself as a scientist on the team, I have to take everything by the method. So we don't even tell her where she's going. We'll tell her to go somewhere else, pick her up, bring her to the location. That she comes in totally fresh.
I know she did pick up spirit activity, but nothing negative. A lot of people say some negative stuff there, but she didn't pick up anything.
She didn't pick it up. Now, what is the common thread that you would say runs among those of your team that compels you all to want to do this kind of work? I mean, it is really an unusual kind of a thing to do. It's not like being a carpenter lawyer, Indian chief, you know, it is very unique.
When we first started this back in 2002, we had meant it to be a limited run. And, you know, here at CTV, we planned it to be just a limited run of episodes, and then we were going to move on to the next project. But by the time we wrapped up the last episode, there was such a positive public reaction to it, and the administration at the time said, yeah, guys, you know, you've got something. So
we just kept doing it. 10 years later, we're still doing it.
So it's the adventure, the adventure.
Partially. I would say, you know, partly we do it because of the adventure, because we're always learning something new, whether it be history or something spiritual or paranormal. We're always learning.
I have to say, while you're sitting here, with Brian, I got that you were a pirate. And
Arg.
Does that feel familiar to you, that feeling, that what I'm saying? I got that you were a pirate, and you were, you could have been a pirate, but, you know, definitely.
I'm new.
Freshly minted.
You're a baby. But does that feel, you feel any connection to that? You ever, a lot of adventure, a lot of need to go out and explore
the
world.
I mean, I still retain a spirit of wanderlust in my life.
Yeah, well, so, that's the pirate. That's the pirate thing.
I always like to travel and explore and go find what's out there, whether it be conceptually or literally, hey, I've never been down this road before. Let's go. Let's see what's down there.
Yeah, so it's that adventurous spirit in you, you know. And, okay, with all the research that you've done over the years, looking for evidence of life after death, do you think you found any answers, or at least do you think you understand it any better than
answers,
you did?
Yes, but every answer we find comes with it more questions. And I think that's just how life goes. You
what's
know, it's
some
a constant evolution of finding out what we're doing here.
What's some answers specifically that you can enlighten our viewers? I mean, people are listening, they're watching you now, and they want to know what answers you think you have found, something specific.
Well, like, I could say personally that I now believe in the paranormal, whereas years ago, I didn't.
Why? Why do you believe in it now?
That's the thing, and I think a lot of, with paranormal investigating too, I can tell you everything, I can show you all my evidence, but you're not going to believe it unless you experience that yourself. And I think that's a lot of it is kind of what you take away from it. Your personal experiences on any investigation. Like, I felt I physically got touched. And it kind of took that to kind of snap.
When you say physically, what happened? You were touched?
In a location, well, I felt like a kind of chill up my spine. Ooh. Like, almost like someone running a finger up it. Uh-huh. And it's not just once. It wasn't just once, because once I can go, yeah, it's psychological. Or if it happens twice, maybe I'm just a little creeped out. But it happened like 5 times in like 5 minutes. I'm like, no, there's something to this. And it was just going on with so many other things, you know, that happened at the same time. It was kind of, for me anyway, it was undeniable.
So that, you had that epiphany.
Yeah, that kind of, that oh crap moment, you know what I mean?
Oh,
I had
God.
That.
How about you, Brian? Like a oh my gosh, like wow, you know, like a revelation.
I think a lot of it for me came with just research and looking into what other people have done before us. I remember, I can remember it vividly. I took a parapsychology course, and when I first learned about EVPs, and when we first started doing this again.
EVPs?
Electronic voice phenomenon. That's disembodied voices captured on audio recordings.
Uh-huh.
Now, when we first started this, we were about exploration. We were about, hey, what can we see? Uh-huh. And now that I found out about EVPs and that there's been all this work done and captured voices, I remember calling Chris and saying, Chris, you'll never believe what I just read. And it literally blew my mind for the rest of that week. I'm like, I almost had nothing to say
about
it.
So you heard voices. Okay, I'm going to mention this. we did a healing about a few weeks ago with one of my special students. And after the healing was done, she said to my teacher, Thomas, hallelujah. And he said, really? Then he turns on this computer a story called Angels Singing Hallelujah. And that student is in the audience, okay? And what it was, talk about EVP. Mm-hmm. Seven parishioners singing a cappella, no music, near Lubbock, Texas. I forgot the year. This is it's somewhat recent, right? They were just practicing. No music. No one had, you know, I mean, maybe the highest voice was, you know, you know, like that.
Right.
But when they played back the tape, the audio, there was fifes, harps, like, what else?
Trumpets.
Clarinets, God knows, and high pitch singing, you know, very higher than that, higher than alto soprano, a pitch that no human could go to, okay? And they were singing Hallelujah. Talk about, you know, voice.
Oh, this guy's had his name called out a couple times lately.
Look up Angel Singing Hallelujah. That's what you know. You've had your name called out?
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. Are we going to the closing? Oh, my God. Oh, we have so much more. Well, you're going to be back for the next show, right?
Sounds good.
This is fantastic.
Thank you for having us.
Really, you guys are amazing. I'm looking forward to the next show.
Us too.
Thank you all for joining us today. If you miss any episodes of Alexandra's Psychic Eye, you can now view us on YouTube. Don't forget to keep tuning in for more shows each week, Friday night on Staten Island and Brooklyn Cable, and Thursday afternoon in Manhattan. Visit psychiceye.tv or call me, Alexandra, at 917-763-0133. Again, 917-763-0133. To receive information on my psychic readings, psychic spiritual life coaching, healings, and individual sessions for meditations for relaxation. And remember, you are all in a state of grace, so continue to work on you. This is Alexandra for Alexandra's Psychic Eye, and thank you for watching. See you next time.